So we're going to be installing MSys2, which is the development environment for Yahoo. It's pretty straightforward. First things first, just to get started from the very beginning, we'll go over to the GitHub page. There's a bunch of links at the Twitch about me. You can click on any one of those and they'll lead you to here. So we'll follow the steps one by one, and we'll get up and running in about 5 to 10 minutes max. So if you already have MSys2 installed for any other reason, you don't have to install MSys2 again. You can just reuse that one. In that case, then you can just jump straight to the first step. But in this case, we're starting from scratch completely. So we're going to download and install MSys2. Click on the first link, go down here, and you should see download installer. Click on that, you download, and you could follow these steps. We're going to be doing these anyways indirectly, but later down the line, down in the future, if there hasn't been a new version out of the installer, you may want to actually do these steps later on. So go down to the desktop, open up MSys2. Okay. So go through the setup. We wait a little bit, show some details, try to see if there's any activity. Should be almost done. Hey, how's it going? So I started a little bit late today. We had some technical issues, but we're back. So just to kind of wrap up, if anybody else has joined, we basically just got through the MSys2 64-bit setup. We're pretty much done here, and we're going to boot up the shell. So let's go back to the instructions. And since we have the shell already opened up, that's step one. Step two is to open up etc/pacman.com. And for those of you that don't know, this is a Unix path. The absolute path being the root of the Unix file system. But since we're working on Windows, wherever you installed MSys is where the root is. But since we don't have an editor in MSys, we can just probably use Notepad++. So we'll get that in, open it up. Go to MSys64. You can see here we have etc. We'll go down to Pacman. Edit with Notepad. And we'll scroll all the way down. And we'll come back. And we'll copy and paste the URL. You don't want to touch anything above here, above line 88 and above. So we'll save the file. Close Notepad. And then the next step is go back to the shell and sync and refresh the databases. So we'll just go ahead and type it. Okay, so we can see that Yahoo MingW-64 got picked up pretty fast. And then the last step is to install everything related to Yahoo. Oops. That's not the button. And then it's about a 330 meg installation. It's pretty fast. It installs pretty much everything you need to get up and running. The tool chain, the examples, the emulator, both of them, any dependencies that you'll need, and of course, a pre-built version of the latest version of Git or Yahoo from Git. Okay. Shouldn't take too long. At some point, I'm gonna get rid of the Python dependency. It's a pretty big and unnecessary dependency. I'll probably go with something where I can go with a pre-compiled executable instead of just running off of Python scripts. But for the moment, we need Python. Okay, all right. So now step five says, once all packages have been installed, close the existing shell and start a new one. So we'll close the existing shell. We'll go back to our root msys and we'll click on it. Open up a new shell. And so step six says, let's go and test the environment. So there's two ways that we can do this. We could either do this completely in the shell, just like how the README has it, or we can go through Windows Explorer. So let's do that. It's probably a little bit more intuitive to some people, which is okay. So as I said before, there's a root path. /opt is really the msys64 root. We'll go down to opt. This YAML examples, and it says to try out vdp1-zoom-sprite. We'll do exactly that. Right click, copy, and we want to go to our home directory, home, and then we'll copy and paste here. Now we need to go back to the shell and actually perform these steps here. Let me close this. So let's cd over to, that's it, yeah, we don't want to escape that. And then let's type out silent1-1, and I'll explain a little bit what that means. Okay, that's it. So make does pretty much the whole process. It processes your C files, any ROM disks you might have. It produces an ELF for debugging, the bin, which is the actual raw binary, executable, the ISO, and the Q file. So since we have Mendefin already installed, we can run it and just pass in the Q file. And then it's going to complain that we need the firmware. So let's just go ahead and do that. Open up Explorer. I already have, well, I'm going to have to get a copy from on my other installation. So ideally, you should already have a copy of the BIOS ready. So let's go back to our path. Oh, and it says in the home directory, not in OPT. So let's go to the home directory. And then Mendefin created the its config directory, and then we'll copy it into firmware. And there it is. So we'll go back up, back to the shell, and we'll call Mendefin. So we'll skip the BIOS. And that's it. This is default, so I don't have my key bindings. I don't know what the defaults are for Mendefin, but effectively this works. We've already booted up a compiled example that we just built with this new setup. So the idea here, let's actually explain what I did up here very quickly. So silent under all uppercase is a variable that pretty much suppresses all output. And leaves out a nice clean line by line step that explains what's happening in the build process. Should there be an error, it's going to output it, and it's going to be a lot easier to sort of like look for that error if you pretty much suppress noise. But if you need to actually see what's happening for any reason, then what you can do is just pass silent with no argument, with no value, and you'll see pretty much exactly what's happening. And then we'll do that again with make, and you can see that it's just a lot of noise. All right. So if, for example, let's go to Emacs and let's open it up. Did I copy it? Okay. No, that's not the right directory. I meant this one. Okay. So we'll go in here. This is the one we just compiled. Emacs on Windows is pretty slow. Usually I'll stick with whatever's on Linux. So let's put in some compilation error and then let's go and do a make clean. Let's keep it silent. And then let's do a make. And then you can immediately see it's the first file and it gets nicely, you can see the error very quickly. So that's about it. That's the only thing. That's its purpose. So let's go back. Let's undo that error. And what we'll do is, since we copied an example that already works, there's maybe we want to either go ahead and manipulate this this copied project, strip everything out that we don't like or that we don't need, and then just start from there. Or we can go back to OPT Yaowo examples and copy the template folder, underscore template, which is basically a stripped down version of every other example that exists. It just doesn't have any code. It has a C file, has a make file, and it has everything you need to just go ahead and get started without having to remove anything. So we'll copy it and call it stream example one. We'll go back. And then here you see two files inside of our stream example, the make file, main.c. But before we continue, we can just compile it, right? Nothing will happen. You'll boot it up and you'll just see a black screen, which is expected. It doesn't necessarily mean that it crashed, but we may want to change the name template into something a little bit more useful. And for that, we need to actually open up the make file. So we'll go back, we'll go to stream example one, and we have the make file here. Most of this stuff here, line fives, starting from line one to line five, can be pretty much ignored. You shouldn't have to touch it unless you really know what you're doing, but I recommend that you don't. Same goes for line 25. Keep it there. It's needed at the very bottom in order for the build process to work. So what's relevant is lines 7 to 23. So starting from the top, sh underscore program is the name of your executable. It's the name of your project. Since we named our project stream example one, we'll just call it that. The next line is where all your C files and any other dependencies are going to be. Right now, we just have main.c and we'll just keep it at that. If you need to add, say, another one, let's do some function. We'll add it to the list. Okay, yeah. So, and that's that. I mean, you can keep them on the same line. It's just a make file. This is easier. I'll explain this a little bit later. This example doesn't actually have one. It's a little complicated. SH libraries is where you want to specify what kind of libraries you need. For example, you may need the TGA library if you want to load TGA files, or you may, if you want to display any 3D, you'll want the Sega 3D library. You can specify those here. But since we're doing a hello world, we really don't need any special libraries at the moment. C flags is any flags you want to pass over to the compiler. These are pretty good defaults, so I would stick with them. There's some other predefined defaults that I have set. You can see them if you clear out the silent flag. You can see what kind of flags I set by default. And if you don't like those, there's a way for you to kind of clobber those and start with your own. But of course, doing something like this could result in some issues with Yaul. And the last part is the IP bin. You can specify each component of the IP bin, and it's going to create an IP bin that reflects those changes. So for IP bin version, I don't know what the valid syntax for the version would be, but I think this is a good enough default. You can change the release date, the area string, the peripherals, and then the title. So we can change this to stream example one. These variables are not capped. There's not going to be an error when you input something that is, say, for example, you know, you look at something like title. If you exceed the, I believe it's 112 bytes, the tools are just going to strip out anything you've exceeded if you go out of bounds. So there's not really much to worry that if you're going to produce like an invalid IP bin. These I would not touch unless if you know what you're doing, especially for the slave and the master stack addresses. These are pretty good enough defaults for most people. The same goes with the first read address, which is pretty standard for most executables, if not all. So we modified exactly what we need. This is pretty much it, unless if you need to go back and you need to add a file to your source, or you need to add a library, or you need to add a include directory. But yeah, this is pretty much it. So let's go back to main, and this is your C file. Yaul at the very beginning, there's a header file called yaul.h. If you're not sure what to include in and you need something specific to Yaul, just include this. It includes pretty much everything you need. In some other cases, you may just want to include exactly what you need to be a little bit more clear, to convey exactly what you're going to be working on. But otherwise, including yaul.h is more than necessary. There's no performance implications here. Just simply put, it's just a one-liner. It's pretty easy. So the next, there's these two functions defined. We all know what main is, but userInit is a little bit special. It's very similar to main in that it gets called, you know, if you wonder when you think about when you define main, who calls main? Well, there's an initialization process that happens, and Yaul does just one extra step, which is it calls user underscore init, and then it proceeds to call main. These two functions are, of course, guaranteed to be only ran once. So user init, if you decide that, you know, you forgot to include it, or you didn't copy from the template and you just did this, you didn't specify user init, it's okay. It's optional, it's not necessary. But the intended behavior, the purpose of user init is you can do virtually whatever you want. Technically speaking, you could just have everything in user init, not even have it. You can have main completely empty. But the idea behind user init is to initialize your game and to separate out the logic a little bit. If you want to initialize, say, the TV resolution, set the back screen, initialize some other components of Yaul, allocate some buffers, things like that. You can do that here. You don't have to. You can just do it in main. But but with this example, I think we're going to just go ahead and use user init. That's what most of the examples have. So let me open up a parallel example so we can just kind of like copy and paste. I don't have IntelliSense on Windows. Okay. Okay, so we're going to bring over some stuff and I'll explain a little bit, what is what. So first thing is we want to just print hello world. We'll keep it simple. We'll just kind of go with what DBGIO does and what its purpose is for YAML. So typically in Unix, you have printf, you have fprintf, and a bunch of other functions to print onto the console. With YAML, you do have printf, but using it is not trivial in that you need to actually implement some file structure plumbing and tell YAML how to actually print out to the screen, or rather where to through this file structure interface. But we're not going to do that. Instead, we're going to use debug input output component from YAML, which is just a nice kind of wrapper around printing onto the screen in different mediums. So for example, with DBGIO, we can tell it to use the VDP2 driver, which means that we want to print onto the screen using the VDP2. If we want to use the VDP1 driver, then we'll tell it to use the driver and it'll use the VDP1 to display text. If, for example, we don't actually want to display on either of the two, but instead we want to say pipe the data out to a console, say through a terminal on your computer, through the USB dev card, then we specify the USB dev card driver. But we're not going to do that. That's a little bit more complicated. It requires more tools. We'll just keep it simple and we'll copy over this. And this just does the initialization of the VDP2 underscore async driver. I could explain a little bit what that does, but I believe I would say that this is for another stream. It's a little bit more complicated. This default just says that there's some predefined default settings structure that's in place. So what that means is it predetermines, it defaults to a very specific location in CRAM. The font is located in a very specific place in VRAM. It uses MBG3 layer, things like that. Just pretty much defaults. Should you need to change these configuration settings, you can use the non-default init and then pass in the necessary struct, and it will just use that. It won't do any error checking per se, but it should be. Should you need it, it's right there for you. So the next function that you want to call is actually the font load, which is what loads the font. I wanted to separate out the two. And the reason why it's an extra step is because you may not want to initialize font loading right now, especially since this font loading will happen as soon as this function is called, despite the driver being asynchronous. This is the reason why you may want to do this is because you may want to wait off until vBlank or turn off the screen or wait for any other reason. But 99% of the time, pretty much this is what follows. You initialize DBGIO and then you call font load. So once that's done, we want to actually go and copy over some, let's see, some actual VDP2 initialization stuff. So we'll type that right here on the side. First things first, we want to actually set the resolution display. And these are very similar. The arguments are similar to what you'll find in the manual. First, we don't want any interlace. The horizontal resolution is going to be normal, which is in the category of 300 normal A, which is 320 pixels wide. The resolution we want to pass just 240, or we can do 224. Either of the two is fine. The second line is optional, but we'll just set it because it's kind of nice to have some color. Actually, I'll type it out. The first argument here for setting the back screen is a location in VRAM. We can use this macro that we have, which is called, which lets you pass in the bank number. With this macro, you can pass in zeros to three. There's always going to be four banks, even if you configure the VDP2 to have just two banks. This just computes an address. It doesn't actually care whether the VRAM banks are split into four or two. So what we want to do is we want to specify 2 bytes for this RGB 555 color at the very last 2 bytes of the fourth bank. And the way we'll do that is we'll specify this, the offset bank 3 with this offset. And then we have a nice macro that allows you to specify the color. MSB, the most significant bit, needs to be set to 1, and we'll set something like, say, 707 or something. And that's it. So with this example here, with the back screen, again, you set the, you specify a location in VRAM where you want this color to be stored, and then you pass in the actual color. VDP2 screen back, the back screen function does the right thing and copies over the color to VRAM. So we initialized the back screen, the display, but at the moment, one thing that I failed, that I forgot to mention was that the display is actually not on. And the reason for that is that we don't, YAML does it so that you don't get any flicker on the screen, ideally. So when your executable goes in, it gets booted from BIOS, you're not setting up and then copying to VRAM, setting up, say, the VDP1 and then clearing out the frame buffers or something, and then just seeing garbage on the screen. So that's why we turn off the display on default. But we can turn it back on by just calling VDP2 TV MD display set. And that should be it for now. If you look at just the bare minimum of what we need, we technically don't need to set the back screen, but we're just going to do that. But at the moment right here, even if we were to run this, we go back, we could try this out, do a make clean, do a make, oh, miss, I forgot this set. Okay. TV and the resolution set. Okay, that should work. Okay, excellent. All right, so let's just run it and we're going to see something important. Okay, so nothing happened. Here you can see that we're in an infinite loop, which is expected. We have a while loop. Actually, after you exit main, there's a while loop that sort of catches sort of like a runoff executable. So that's why we're seeing an infinite loop, which is expected. So now, since we initialize the resolution, we set the back screen, we initialize the VGIO, and we turn on the display, why is nothing showing up, at least the color, right? The reason is because YAML is completely buffered. And what that means is that depending on which component of the hardware or the system that we're talking about, namely in this case, VDP2, nothing actually happens until you actually synchronize with the hardware. And what that means is that you set up and change the state of the hardware. Again, in this case, we set up the back screen, enabled the display, and all of that is buffered. It's stored somewhere in HRAM. There's a bunch of state that just gets stored in memory. So at this point, all we did was just modify a bunch of buffers, but the hardware itself actually hasn't done anything really, aside from the initialization process. So what we need to do is we need to do a sync. And what sync does is it takes those buffers, everything we've set up that we've done so far, and actually synchronize it with the hardware. It commits the changes out to the hardware. So this will actually write out to the VDP2 registers, and you should see a change. But the one thing about VDP2, well, let's call this first actually before I continue. So that's the function. Whenever you need to actually see something on the screen, you call that. It's very similar to SGL's version, but don't know exactly whether SGL blocks here or not, but in the case of Yaowoo, it does not block. So if you were to call this, call VDP2 sync, and then just continue on, if you forget to call VDP2 sync wait, then what will happen is you're going to go immediately back. If this is, say, for example, in a loop, this was like an infinite loop, right? If you were to do something like this, you're going to be updating the screen a ton of times. It doesn't wait for vBlank. And so that's not the intended behavior. There's no checks for it. You're going to need to call in VDP2 underscore sync wait. And what this will do is it will just simply wait until you've completely synchronized. And what that also means is that it will, once this function returns, it's going to take you back to the very start of vBlank out. So effectively a sync is sort of waiting for a full frame. So here, now that we're complete, now that we call sync, we can go back and we can compile. We'll make clean again. And then let's call medlifin. And then skip the settings or skip the boot up. Okay, now we see something on the screen. And that's the color we chose. So the back screen is set up, but we still don't have anything to display, no text. So let's do that now. And for that, you know, we, like I said before, user init is kind of where you want to do your initialization. I think this is more than enough. We can actually implement some logic in main. We could do that here, but the purpose of this example is to actually print out some text. So for that, we want to use dbgio printf. Type in hello world. Now I'll just go ahead and run this. Okay, so this is exactly what we expected. We printed, well, not really. Yes and no. We did a printf, a dbgio printf, and we expect to see something on the screen, but we don't. So the reason why that's the case is because alongside the VDP2 functions, dbgio is also buffered, meaning that when we call dbgio printf and write hello world, that just gets written to an internal buffer that dbgio controls. And the way to actually see something on the screen, we have to call dbgio flush. So this function explicitly tells dbgio to flush onto the screen. And that depends again on the driver. So since we chose VDP2, that's going to update VRAM to actually show the string hello world. The reason why we do this and we don't just automatically say print onto the screen as soon as we call printf or as soon as we're done calling printf is for performance reasons. And also there's going to be glitches if you're calling printf at the wrong time. So ideally, you want to be able to do a printf around the time when you're ready to do a sync. We'll run this and we'll see what happens. Again, a make clean, a make, and then we'll call Mendafin. Nothing. So there is a reason for that again. Even though we flush to the frame buffer, or sorry, not the frame buffer, onto VDP2, we actually have not. And this goes back to what I mentioned about VDP2 async. Async, what flush does for this very specific driver is that when the flush happens, it queues itself. It enqueues a request for when VDP2 is going to be synchronized. So it's actually waiting for you, the programmer, to call VDP2 sync. And since we haven't done that, you're not going to see anything on the screen. If we were to choose the synchronous driver, then what will happen is DBGIO flush will actually flush right at the moment. And this is useful for other cases, for when, namely within the internals of YAML, where we don't have a way to perform an asynchronous task. So we actually have to use the driver that writes straight to VRAM right when you flush. And when I say asynchronous, I don't actually mean multi-threaded or any threads or fibers or anything like that. It's just asynchronous in a sense that the flushing happens later, as soon as you call sync, right? It's disconnected. So let's do that. Let's copy and paste. And let's go down here. And then let's do a make clean. Make. Mendafin again. Okay, so now we see it. This is pretty much it. There's a lot of lines of code. It takes about 32 lines of code to print out Hello World. It's a little bit more complicated, of course, than Joe and arguably SGL, but here you get a little bit, and in this case, not so much. The differences are pretty nil, but regardless, it's just a little bit more, I would say. You actually have to understand the hardware a little bit more, and that's okay, but it gives you a lot of flexibility. So we'll go through one more small example, and we'll kind of extend out this this Hello World, and we'll actually add in a infinite loop, our game loop, and we expect, so here, this is where things kind of change between SGL and I believe Joe, and maybe even SBL, in that printf, printing onto the screen behaves a lot differently. If you've noticed, we never actually specify any coordinates for our printf, and there's a very specific reason for that. But first, I'll show exactly what happens here. First, again, we'll printf, we'll flush, sync, we'll wait for sync. Next frame, we should see Hello World and on repeat. Okay, so this is what happens. So it might not be what you expected, but if we were to type this out and we were to do a print Hello World on, say, Linux, Unix, and what have you, even on DOS, this is pretty much the same behavior, and this is very much intended. the printf is tied directly down to a terminal, a very simplistic stripped down terminal emulator, and it behaves very much like a typical shell, a Linux shell. So in order for us to combat this, we have to kind of go with Unix-like solutions. What we want to do here is we want to just print hello world once on the top left of the screen and nothing more. So let's go back. And what we want to do is we want to pass in some escape sequences. So this one is, what we're doing here is a backslash X, which means that our string is going to have a character 1B, which is the escape character. And this, even though this is multiple characters, once printf consumes this this string, it's going to treat it as a single character. It's going to parse it as that. Then we have an open bracket and we specify the actual coordinates from the top left of the screen, which is one indexed, not zero indexed. And then we split the arguments, separate the arguments, I mean, using a semicolon. And then the command itself is uppercase H. So what we're doing here, the very first thing is we're resetting the cursor. There is, just like in a shell, there is a cursor, but we have it, it's invisible. We can't actually see it in YOL, but it's there. What we want to do is we want to reset the cursor to the top left of the screen every time. So when this runs at line 26, the first thing that happens is the cursor gets set to the top left and then hello world gets printed. We flush, we sync, next frame. By the time we're here, before we call dbgio printf, the cursor is somewhere after the exclamation mark, but we don't want it there. So again, using this escape sequence, it resets the cursor to the top left of the screen. More importantly, the next step is what we want to do is we want to issue another command, and that's done through the same method, which is backslash x 1b open bracket 2j. And what this one does is it takes in the current cursor position, which is at the top left, and it will clear out, it will zero out the screen from its current, from the current cursor position all the way to the max cursor position, to the bottom right of the console, which is 32 divided by 8, which is 8 being the number of pixels per character. So this is effectively what we want. So let's save. Let's take a shortcut and we can do this. So what this does is it just goes through all three commands at the same time. It makes clean, and then it makes, and conditionally, if make succeeds and there's no compilation error, it will call magnifin. And just like what we expected, nothing happens. It goes back to the original, to the previous, to the first example, rather. So this is pretty much it. Let's say that we want to pass in a variable, call it I, and we want to increment it every frame. So standard printf arguments. This is a variadic function, so we pass in I. This is all standard C library functions. It behaves the same way. So let's go back. And there we go. So this When the cursor goes set back to the top left position, the string gets bigger and bigger as time goes on. There's more to clear. So that's why we did the 2J command. Speaking about these commands, there's a place where we can kind of like look and see what each one does. So this should be, let's see if this one is. No, let's do terminal. Here we go. This should be it. Okay, so there's a bunch of them. This is the escape command. So the it's represented in hex. And this is the actual character control key representation. As I said before, you can just type in backslash X 1B. And then here's some other commands. We used this one, it's called cup, I guess, home positioning to X and Y coordinates in the console. So the arguments are you first put in the escape key character, open bracket, the X position, the Y position separated by a semicolon, and then H. You can also do something by default, which sets, you don't have to specify one semicolon, one, you can just specify H. These commands probably don't work. I doubt it. They probably do get parsed out by the terminal emulator inside DVGIO, but I don't think anything is going to happen. So they're this one, these are, we didn't go through these, but K would clear out the line from the current position to the end. 1K from the beginning to the current position, and then 2K would just clear out a single line. Let's go. These don't work. This is a little bit too heavy-handed for Sega Saturn. Same with the colors, background. But it doesn't seem like it's actually covering the 2J. Well, it has it here, but it doesn't actually cover it. But yeah, nonetheless, we can find a better page. But this is the information. This isn't anything unique to DVGIO or Yahoo in general. Let's see, what was I going to cover? There was something else. Ah, there's something special. So let's do float numbers. This is, or fixed numbers. So. Whatever, 1.5, I think this is good. So printf typically supports percentage F, which is to print floats, but I have printf modified so that instead it doesn't actually parse floats, which would be not good. Instead it parses fixed point. So we can specify the argument ampersand F and print out and pass in foo, and let's do something like 0.1. Let's see if that works. And there we go. Fixed point, integers, clears the screen. Debug output to the screen. I think that this is pretty much the most basic approach to getting started with Yahoo. I think, if I can remember, I don't think that there's anything left. I guess if anybody's in the chat still, yeah, I guess this is it then. Well, thank you guys. Thank you for joining. Have a good night.